time to hang 10. Here's Rocco Pilato of the Murph Morning Show.
Hey, what's up? Welcome to the latest episode of Hang 10. We do just what the name says. We hang for 10 minutes or so with a special guest each week. This week, we're joined by Lizzie Hale from the Grammy-winning rock band Hailstorm. Lizzie, welcome to our Hang 10 podcast. How you doing?
I'm doing great. Thank you so much. It's so great to talk to you. It really is.
Now, let's go back for people that may not be aware. Some of your earliest live performances were on our old Homegrown show, which aired Monday nights, 10 o'clock. You guys, you and your brother RJ, and your mom and dad, that you would drive from Red Lion, drive home in the middle of the night just to do our show. You were just kids back then, right?
Yeah, we were babies. But, you know, the hustle was real. We didn't mind, you know, driving around and making it happen. The fact that we were on your show, because I think at the time I must have been like, what, 14, something like that, mm-hmm. you know, and 13 or 14. And that was, I believe, one of the first times we had ever actually heard our stuff on the radio. And it was so magical. This is like before you even know anything about the industry. And you know, the fact that you took a chance on some kids, even, you know, yeah, okay, it was Monday night at 10, but that was awesome. You're like, wow, this is crazy. To look back and talk about those things, we look back on that stuff so fondly because, you know, even before, you know, we really knew what we were doing, we knew that this was, you know, okay, yes, we're crazy, but this isn't stupid. There's something here. And no matter what, we got to see it through. So you were a great launching point from that, you know?
No, thank you. I mean, we loved having you. Your mom would always bring Phillies gear, RJ's outgrown Phillies shirts, and give them to our youngest son. So that was always awesome as well.
I know. That's awesome. I can't remember that.
Now, you were on the old Homegrown show a number of times, but the one in particular that you shared, it was like your 20th anniversary of being a band, and you shared this, and I thought it was great. The songs you played that night, you did three live, and we did a couple from your album back then. You did Allie Said, Holding On to the Storm, and Thinking, all live. Then we played I Could Fly and Time Man. Those are your oldest songs. Do you ever play any of those, ever get the itch to just, you know, let's bust this one out?
There was one time, I think it was a few years ago, my brother and I were hanging at my house, and I have a piano in my house, and I'm like, Archie, do you want to do a small, like, video? I think we posted it somewhere, but small video of Time Man we ended up doing, or no, I think it was Love is Power, one of them, you know, where, like, just kind of went back, and it was so funny, because Lil Bro, like, remembered all the parts, you know, without needing to reference it, and I'm like, yeah, some of this stuff sticks, but wow, with Allie Said, that was something that I wrote for my best friend in middle school in seventh grade. And I think it was actually a project that my English teacher was giving me, like, oh, you should, you know, something about poetry. I'm like, well, I write songs, and she would put them on the board and everything. And that was one of them. Like, oh, see? All right, cool. We can play that one too, little bro. Like, that's like, now that's a song. It used to be homework, now it's a song.
Now you... You talk so lovingly about RJ, your little brother. Do you guys ever, especially when you're out on tour, you have any, like, Oasis moments, the Gallagher brothers, where you're just at each other's throat? Or do you two generally get along pretty well together?
We get along really great. He's my little buddy. And it's funny because with everything that we've done as a band, that we've gone through, and that, you know, the uphill battle, we've always had to do together. So I think that early on kind of solidified, like, there's every now and then there's like small spats, like, you know, like anything else, like, okay, you're annoying now this week or something like that. but I think because of the brother sister thing, we know how to fight without breaking the whole thing up. You know, it's like we know how to do that. Maybe it would have been different if it was brother or sister. Maybe there would be more competition. But I think because of that separation too, and just considering he and I are kind of polar opposites anyway, as I'm sure you can remember him bouncing off the walls and whatever.
Yep.
And so he's always been the Jerry Lewis to my Dean Martin. And it's worked that way, I think. You know, we respect each other and what each other does. And I don't know. Yeah, we don't really fight much. Like I said, it's just kind of, it's always kind of been us against the world, so.
Now, your fourth album, Vicious, is out now. The video came out, what, was that yesterday that the video came out for Vicious?
Yes, it did, actually.
It's fantastic, by the way. You know, it's funny. I check, and it was like out 3 minutes ago. It was released 3 minutes ago, already 2.5 million views. That's got to feel good when you see those numbers jump like that as soon as you release something.
Oh, well, Rocco, absolutely. I mean, you know, you remember, it's like, I remember, you know, when I was, you know, a kid and we first started, and, you know, we, but we I remember talking about, like, hey, do you think anyone will ever want an autograph? You know, that'd be crazy. You know, it's like, so the fact that we're able to release things here and actually able to call this a career, and I'm living the dream. I think that is the definition, where it's, I get to, you know, travel the world doing what I love every single day with the people that I enjoy doing it with. You know, that's really crazy. When you stop and smell the road and stuff, think about it, it's like, yeah, this is nuts that we're still doing this. Can you believe this?
Well, you know, I would think one of the things that comes with your success is giving you the ability to do some things that you want to do in addition to the things you have to do. Like, you just put out your fourth album a few months ago called Vicious, but you've got these EPs, and I love these things so much, where you do covers, and you do the kind of stuff that we'd expect, like the Skid Row, the AC/DC, the Pat Benatars, the Whitesnakes, stuff that's kind of in line with what Hailstorm does. But you've got some covers on there which are fantastic, like Lady Gaga and Daft Punk and Pharrell Williams' Get Lucky. That's mind-blowing to me. What is it about those songs? Is it for fun, or are those songs that you really love? Like, why do you choose stuff like that?
I think that we do it for the challenge, honestly. I love kind of reaching out and doing something that I know in the back of my head, okay, maybe I would never do this normally, you know? And it's a really safe things to do that in those cover EPs, because, you know, the songs are already proven. It's not like you're, you know, writing out of midair and having to, you know, get, you know, opinions from everybody as to whether it's good or not. These songs are already proven, so you can kind of have fun with them. And some songs, you know, you have to, all it needs is just for you to play it. And then other songs, you really have to figure out how you're going to, like, execute this as the man that you are. And that's where, like, that kind of magic happens, and we end up taking a lot of those exciting things that we learn from doing those covers, and we apply it to the next record. You know, like, for instance, if, you know, if we hadn't done that Skid Row cover, Slave to the Grind, that we would have never, like, kind of were inspired by that tempo to do one of our songs called Love Bites on the next record. So, you know, with those little excitements, like, oh, man, like, we've never done this before, and it works. Let's apply it to a new song, you know? So it's a lot of fun to do those things. And it's fun for the fans, too. You get to freak them out a little bit. Like, seriously? Like, what are you doing? Damn, I was your lover. Seriously? You know, like, so that's kind of funny, too. Like, where it's like, Some of the songs were like, yeah, maybe we shouldn't have done that one, but it's out there now.
I love it. I'm telling you, I look forward to those things. Take us through a normal day. Now, let's just say you're on the bus. We're not talking about when you fly in somewhere. We're talking you're on the bus, you're going from one venue to the next. Give us an idea of what you do during the day on tour.
Well, during the day, usually I wake up and there's a little bit of radio press in the morning. So I wake up, cup of coffee, that kind of thing. You know, talk to some people, some early morning radio guys, and you go in for sound check. And you, maybe there's some, like, kind of semi breakfast lunch, because this is around, like, probably around 11 noon to, you know, 1 to 2, depending on when we got into the venue. And so it's kind of a, you know, a brunch situation. And then, you do sound check, and then there's a meet and greet, and then dinner somewhere in there. Sometimes if we have a little bit of time, we get lost. Usually some interviews in there as well. And then about an hour out before the show, we kind of have a rule as a band, you know, that we get together at least an hour out and just start jamming together, just kind of getting on the same wavelength, you know, as far as musically. And then we do the rock show, and then we try to subdue the excitement or amp it up after the show. Harder to get back to sleep. That usually means we stay up till about 2 in the morning, then go to bed and kind of do it all over again.
Yeah, I can't imagine.
It's pretty crazy.
I can't imagine going out, doing what you do, and being that fired up, and then, you know, within a half hour being asleep. It would keep me up all night long. I don't know how you do it. Even 3-4 hours is amazing that you're able to settle down that quickly.
Oh, yeah, it's tough. You get into a certain routine sometimes. I know Little Brother's a creature of habit, so, you know, he'll start, you know, after like maybe an hour or two, like post show, and everyone's getting crazy, he'll start like, okay, maybe I should like have some tea and try to wind down. You know, because it's tough for me. It's even harder for little bro. You know, I think that if he didn't have to sleep, he wouldn't. You know, but it's cool, man. It's like it's really crazy to like actually be busy and having like, okay, think about this, like having a bus as a normal part of your life. I mean, I remember the first time we ever like were on somebody else's bus and we were all awkward and like, do we ask for water? No, I don't think we should. We'll just sit here and be weird. And so the fact that like that's a part of our normal life is really crazy too. You know, it's been a long journey, but in a lot of ways, Rocco, and I say this, you know, in the most positive way possible, we're still just as immature. That's the one common thread from when we first started. We still talk about the same joke. I think rock and roll stunts your growth. You know, as soon as you get into it and you start getting obsessed, you just stop right there. Like the sense of humor. Now we're like, we're still kids, but now we're trying to adult. You know, now the adulting thing is, you know, now we got to figure that out. So yeah, it's pretty cool. It's crazy, but very cool.
We're going to give you 10 quick ones. All we're going to do, we're going to give you 10 quick questions. First thing that pops in your mind, the answer that you come up with, that's okay. The one we want to hear, okay?
All right.
Number one, you versus RJ. If you both watched the TV game show Jeopardy together, who would win, you or RJ?
Oh, absolutely RJ. He might forget his keys and his wallet and his, you know, cell phone everywhere, but he remembers that kind of stuff. He remembers, like, if he hears it once, so he's crazy like that. So definitely RJ.
Favorite cartoon character?
Oh, man. Marvin the Martian.
You're
I was expecting an earth-shattering kaboom.
That was very good. You're a competitive eater. What's the one food you could compete for to win a national championship?
I am a whole pizza to myself type of person, so I think I'm going to have to go with pizza.
All time.
I could probably do two if everyone would stop looking at me funny, if I could go for two.
All time favorite band?
Ooh, Black Sabbath, hands down.
Favorite color?
I'll go with purple. I'll go with the real color.
Where is your 2013 Grammy sitting right now?
Oh, I'm actually right in front of it. It is on, stereotypically, on a mantle of a fireplace right next to the third place trophy from 1997 Schuylkill County Fair.
That's fantastic. That may be the coolest thing I've ever heard. Very nice. The favorite tour you ever did, who was it with?
Oh, you know what? Honestly, it has to be our first tour ever. First national tour was with Seether and Shinedown, and they spoiled us, and we had no idea what we were doing, and we ended up coming home with like a trailer full of, you know, wine and tequila because they were so nice. And then we went on the next tour, and we had like bags for water, so we were like, "Oh, the touring thing is easy. These guys are great." Then you go on the next tour, like, "Oh, wait, nobody. That doesn't really happen on tour." So yeah, that was a great one.
Your all-time favorite movie.
Ooh, man, that is so tough because it's like I either have to go with Almost Famous or Spinal Tap, or The Big Lebowski. That's a good one too. I'm going to go with Almost Famous because if that comes on, you have to watch the whole thing.
All-time favorite female singer.
Ooh, Ann Wilson from Heart.
Favorite form of social media.
Right now it's Instagram because you can just kind of put a picture up there and then everyone starts talking about it. That's safer than, you know, 4 a.m. and Lizzie has something funny to say on Twitter and then it's out there forever.
Yeah, you're right. Hey, it's Lizzie Hale of Hailstorm. You can catch the band live in Allentown on July 17th, a couple days later, right outside Pittsburgh. Lizzie, thanks for joining us on Hang 10. Looking forward to the tour and can't wait for some more music from you.
Darling, thank you so much. And I hope that you know how important you were in our journey and just, you know, keeping that spark going early on. And we really appreciate you as being a part of that.
All right. You made me misty. That's our Hang 10 this week. I'm Rocco Pilato of the Murph Morning Show. Thanks for listening. And make sure you head to your favorite social media platforms. Give us a follow. Look for Murph Radio on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We'll be back next week with another Hang 10. Till then, bye-bye.
And that's this week's Hang. Come back again next week as we hang 10 with another special guest.